Thank you very much. I want to welcome you all to today's event on ethnics and journalism in conflict zones. And I think it's really hard to come up with a topic that is more timely and more timeless, and that, you know, this is hardly the first situation where these issues have been addressed. And thinking about Eastern Ukraine, but you know, these are common issues that unfortunately creep up in lots of parts of the world and in various periods in history. So we've got a great panel, and I think you're really in for a treat, for people who can really address this issue from a range of perspectives, with deep local knowledge of the issue and the problems on the ground in Eastern Ukraine, but also I think the panelists really give us a sense of how complex these issues are and the kinds of balancing that needs to be done in order to get the story and tell the truth to power and to get the facts out, at the same time making wise decisions about your own personal safety. Also having to deal with parties who are very interested in spinning you in one way or another, knowing that you have to make decisions in real time and be the eyes and ears for the world who can't be there. I'm really interested to hear about how these decisions get made. And we've just got a tremendous panel to help us sort through the whole range of very complex issues surrounding the issue of ethics in writing about ethics in conflict zones. First, let me start off by introducing Nina Berman, who is an associate professor of journalism at the Columbia Graduate School of Journalism. She is the author of two monographs, Purple Hearts, Back from Iraq and Homeland, and she's won World Press Foundation photo awards. She has is a former teacher at the International Center of Photography in New York City. She's lectured at universities and conferences, and it's really, I think, a testament to her reputation that a number of our Klebnikov fellows have said, oh, make sure when I come, I want to meet Nina Berman. So I think that really speaks well of her reputation in Russia. We also have Judith Matloff, adjunct associate professor of journalism, again at the Columbia Graduate School of Journalism, and her expertise is covering these issues abroad in a whole range of settings. Her articles have appeared in the New York Times Magazine, The Economist, Financial Times, and Newsweek. She's got fellowships from the MacArthur Foundation and Fulbright, and she's also, I think, particularly important for today's discussion, been really a pioneer in developing programs for journalists to navigate safety issues during periods of conflict. And she has an incredible list of clients who have picked up on this real need to give advice to these smart journalists who are trained in writing and research and all these topics, but maybe haven't given a whole lot of thought to how to keep yourself safe when conflict is ensuing all around you. And of course, we have Maria Turchenkova, who is our 2015 Paul Klebnikov Russian Civil Society Fellow, and she'll be in residence in Harriman from April 1st until April 22nd. She's our first photojournalist that we've chosen as a Klebnikov Fellow, and we're really excited to present her work. There's an exhibit that's being shown in the fourth floor in the School of International Affairs building. There's also an opening that tomorrow evening at the Journalism School, where we'll be presenting her work and hearing more about her work. She's done just tremendous work on photojournalism in during the conflict in Eastern Ukraine, also tremendous work in the North Caucasus, and she has a new project on the Middle East as well. Her works have appeared in New York Times, Time Magazine, Le Monde, Der Spiegel, The Guardian, the list goes on and on and on. And we're just really excited to have her here, not just for this event, but also we'll be able to ruthlessly exploit her presence for the next few weeks as well. And then finally, we have Ann Cooper, who is CBS professor of professional practice international journalism and a longtime member of the Harriman Institute. She was a foreign correspondent for NPR in Moscow. She was the NPR bureau chief. She was later covered the United Nations for NPR. She was also, you know, for a long time member and now the executive director of the Committee to Protect Journalists, which of course is one of the leading organizations and advocacy groups to protect press freedom and particularly those who are engaged in the journalists who of course make the press freedom possible. I've said more than enough, but we've got a tremendous panel, and what I'd like to do is turn the floor over to Ann Cooper, who will be moderating the discussion. So please join me in welcoming our really distinguished group of panelists today.
Thank you, Tim. When we talk about covering conflict or being a war correspondent, obviously safety and security are prime issues. But for any journalist covering conflict, there are many other issues well beyond just keeping yourself safe and secure. By its nature, violent conflict always has, at a minimum, two sides to the story. So how do you as a journalist cover those sides and try to give your audience a full picture of the entire conflict? And how do you do that fairly? If you choose to embed with one side or the other, how do you avoid being co-opted or even censored? And how do you deal with issues involving the civilians who increasingly seem to be caught in the middle of so many conflicts today? Those are some of the questions that our panelists today are prepared to grapple with. And to set the scene for that, I want to just take a few minutes to talk about some history of war correspondence going way back. There's a great book on this subject called The First Casualty by British writer Philip Knightley. The title, First Casualty, refers to a truism of, I guess, somewhat disputed origin, which I won't go into, but it's the full thing is the first casualty of war is truth. And in Philip Knightley's book, his first chapter is about a journalist named William Howard Russell, who was neither the first war correspondent nor the greatest war correspondent, but Knightley makes a very good case for why he's the starting point for this book that he did. William Howard Russell covered the Crimean War in the 1850s for the Times in London. And you know, the significance that Knightley ascribes to him is this. He says that William Howard Russell's coverage was the beginning of an organized effort to report a war to the civilian population at home using the services of a civilian reporter. Now, there's evidence of just how groundbreaking Russell's effort was just in the correspondence that he was sending back to his editors in London. He traveled with British troops east toward the Crimean war fronts and started sending home dispatches. And among the things he was saying was, you know, our troops are really inexperienced, ill-prepared, pretty incompetent. A lot of what he was writing was comparing what he saw of the British troops versus the French troops who were also, you know, going off to war and who he could see firsthand. Another big theme in what he was writing home was how ill-prepared the British military was to give medical aid to its wounded. And again, he was comparing, you know, the Brits with the French military that he was seeing. But this was like new ground. There had not been a civilian reporter sent by the Times off to cover previous wars. And so William Howard Russell is writing this stuff back in, you know, letters to his one of his editors, and he wasn't really too sure what he was supposed to be doing or saying. So in one of these letters where he's talking about incompetence, lack of good medical care, et cetera, he says, "Am I to tell these things or hold my tongue?" And the response from his editor was, "Continue to tell as much truth as you can." And so that's what William Howard Russell did in his coverage of the Crimean War. And in a lot of what he did, I think we can see a legacy that's carried on really to much of the conflict reporting today. For example, by telling as much truth as you can, William Howard Russell often earned the wrath of the British military. He got threats. He was camping out with the soldiers, had his own tent. Tent got cut down one time when they were really angry at something that he wrote. Officers would refuse to speak with him. He was essentially embedded, which we're going to be talking about some today, but he got thrown out of his embed and had to kind of run around, you know, after the troops to keep up with them, but stay outside of them because he had become persona non grata because of this, you know, trying to tell as much truth as he could. Here's another legacy of William Howard Russell's reporting. By following that instruction on telling as much truth as he could, his dispatches home were full of eyewitness descriptions. He wrote what he saw and what he heard directly from soldiers and officers in the field. And that may sound like journalism 101, like why would that be a big deal? But it actually was. And the reason is that his dispatches were the first of their kind for the British press. Before that, when, you know, Britain was at war or, you know, involved somewhere militarily, the daily papers in London actually relied on officers, British military officers in the field, to write back and say how things were going. These were not very timely accounts usually because, you know, after all, they were pretty busy fighting a war. So, you know, writing about what was happening was not their top priority. And as you can imagine, the dispatches that officers sent home were certainly not independent, disinterested reporting. Do you think they were going to write about, oh, we're really incompetent or we don't do very well in treating our wounded soldiers? No, you're not going to get that kind of stuff using that as your source. And that was one of the reasons why the decision was made to send William Howard Russell off as the first civilian war correspondent for the Times. Let's get a more honest accounting of what's going on. This war is very important. The whole effort is very important. The country is very interested in it. You know, we want some good reporting. Today, we would not accept for a second, you know, accounts that only relied on the military leaders to tell us how things were going in a conflict. But that is, prior to William Howard Russell, essentially what the British papers were doing. Here's another legacy of Russell's reporting. He showed us that independent reporting, trying to tell as much truth as you can about a conflict, can actually move public opinion. It doesn't always. There's no guarantee. You guys probably can think of many examples, but it can. When you have honest, independent reporting, you know, as much truth as you can find out and report back, it has that potential. People want to know what's being done in the name of their country with the soldiers who are out there, you know, fighting on their behalf. And Russell's reporting certainly did that. First of all, his stories about inadequate medical care for the wounded prompted many private donations of aid and inspired Florence Nightingale to recruit nurses to send out to help the wounded, the British wounded who were fighting the Crimean War. They were all doing something that the British government was failing to do for its soldiers. And how did people know that? They knew that because of this independent correspondent going out and reporting. Russell's accounts also eventually helped turn public opinion against the war effort. He was there as an eyewitness at the charge of the Light Brigade when British soldiers rode their horses straight into Russian cannons and into death. And his eyewitness account of that military disaster remains a classic of war journalism. It's amazing writing, pretty devastating to read even today. And it became an early example of the influence that independent war reporting can have. So here's how Philip Knightley summed up the importance of this correspondent, William Howard Russell. His war reporting was considerably closer to the truth than anything the public had previously been permitted to learn, and his influence on the conduct of the Crimean campaign was immense. So more than a century and a half later, we're gathered here today with some people who know, journalists who know quite a lot about conflict reporting, modern day conflicts, modern day reporting. And we're going to examine some of the many questions, ethics, and approaches to this reporting. And so to open the discussion, I want to turn to Maria, and Tim has introduced everybody very well. So I'm just going to turn it over to you, Maria, and I know you've got a presentation here, right?
Yeah, I prepared a small presentation on what is it. I prepared a small presentation on what it is like to cover the war in Ukraine. And I start with the, my journey along across Ukraine started in Maidan. And I will not focus so far on this issue, as we saw so many pictures from Maidan and it was so well discussed. But in general, I came there in December of 2013 when thousands of people gathered to protest against the decision of the Ukrainian government and the Ukrainian president to decline the agreement with the European Union and proclaiming by that the closer ties with Russia. And afterwards, the story brought me to Crimea. And it was the first time when I felt that there is no other way to tell this story than to cover it and to show it from both sides. I got an assignment from the French newspaper Le Monde, and their idea was to show Crimea to Europe, to describe what it is like, and I proposed them to make the overall trip around the peninsula to show every day a town, any town in Crimea, and to show what people think there. In the long run, I came to decision that I should show both pro-Ukrainian and pro-Russian, pro-Russian people. I will show you quickly how it looked like. Every day before the referendum, we published a piece covering and showing how people are split. So I was choosing a person, I was just going to him on the street and I was asking what he thinks about. And there were, like, here is the quote from people, and they were saying, like, those who were dreaming to go to be a part of Russia, they were saying that there are so many, the salaries are high in Russia, and that all the revolution scared them. And those who wanted to stay in Ukraine, they were like explaining in most patriotic feelings what they feel about this division and why they want still stay in the in Ukraine. So this could be any person I could find, and I tried to make as much broad choice of professions or places as I could. Tatars, the Berkut soldier who was in Maidan and who was on the line against the protesters, and he after escaped to Crimea. So it was the first time when I found myself interested to show not one line in the story, but try to show it from both sides. And as far as the division was widening, I found myself in the East Ukraine. Um, So what it was like to for the journalist to be in the East Ukraine from the beginning? First of all, there was a feeling that I'm sorry, I'm a little bit nervous because I'm not used to the public events. I believe that this war in the East Ukraine is made by media, first of all, because everyday propaganda from both sides was issuing news and lies, and which provoked people to raise anger inside them. So from one moment, I realized that I find myself in a strange position of a person who loses the sense of reality, because there were some news of tanks with swastika going towards the East Ukraine from one side, or the Chechen fighters occupying and terrifying the cities from another side. So when I tried to follow this kind of fake news, I felt myself like I'm catching the white rabbit. So in the long run, I realized that there is no one way to cover this war objectively than to try to go to both sides and to try to stay at the place as long as I can. I spent there 7 months last year, going in and out, as there is some migration regulation between Russia and Ukraine now. But I still did my best to spend as much time as I can in the place. And what is special about the war in Ukraine is that the Donbas, the area which is claimed to be, which wants to separate, is not isolated. So you can still manage to go in and out, unless you work for the Russian governmental media, or unless you work for the Ukrainian media. And for me, being Russian, it was much easier to go to the Ukrainian side in comparison to the Ukrainian journalists who are just under threat when they come to the pro-Russian side. And I used this opportunity as much as I could, just trying to catch as many and to witness as much as I can. And through all my work, I settled some rules of how should I behave, what should I do, what should I care of. And first of all, the first rule was to go on both sides and to manage to do it every time, like to spend several days on the pro-Russian side, to go and to cross the line and to go for the Ukrainian side. And I remember some disputes between my colleagues who cover Middle East. Is there any sense of crossing the line? Isn't it better to stay just on one side, and is it worth to cross the line and to be under, to take this risk? In Ukraine, it's worth that, because unless you don't see the situation from both sides, you cannot look at this objectively. The second rule, which I figured out for myself, is that I'm never embedded with any group. First of all, when you cross the line or you cover the front line, it can be bigger danger for a journalist to go with some military groups, because there is no roadmap and nobody knows where the fight can be. So most of the time, I jumped into the situation. I just traveled with my correspondent or my driver, and just came to the checkpoints. I was coming to the frontline trenches. I was going to different battalion groups, or more to the civilians who suffered from both sides. And that was the the better way to cover that, because I could see more and I could show more. The third rule I figured out is to care as much as I can about the information I have, because the information there is gold. So when I cross the border, when I cross the front line, I was thinking always that I have a high responsibility to save the information, either like on the pro-Russian side, either on the Ukrainian side, not to put people who trusted me and who showed me the faces and who were telling me the stories, not to put them under threat or under risk. Because it's just crazy how attentively both sides follow the coverage of this war. In all languages, French, Finnish, just any language the journalists write in, both sides follow. So here I wanted to show you the accreditations, which are issued by the People's Republic in Donetsk. And this actually helps you on the checkpoints, and this is kind of protection of journalism, journalists. But this can be the biggest issue on another side. So as far as you cross the border, and you cross the you cross the front line, you change the accreditations. And there is another one issued by the Ukrainian side, which is also the press card for the journalist. And actually, it appeared to be only recently, and actually it works. It helps to cross the line. But coming back to the question, if it's worth to cross this line, from some point it became the part of the deal for me, because most of the from different sides of the conflicting territory, there are so-called humanitarian corridors. So they're supposed to be for civilians to go in and out, but it doesn't work. So for me as a journalist, it became important not only to see both sides, and because after several months, it was all the same. People were suffering, funerals, different battalions. They were all saying the same. Just the level of being desperate and disappointment, and this was rising. But in the long run, after several months, it stayed the same. So from some point, it was important for me to take these roads and to cross these lines to show that it's not safe, that people are trapped in the crossfire and they have no opportunity to leave. Although in official papers or in the official news from both sides, in Russian and Ukrainian, these roads existed. And when I took them, it was the biggest risk I took in my life. And the missiles were falling around. So that's why it was important. And I want to tell you one particular story, which is called Cargo 200. If you know, it was used to mark, it was used during the war in Afghanistan to mark those who were killed and being repatriated to Russia. They used Cargo 200 for those who died. They used Cargo 300 for those who were injured. So, since so many years, it first appeared again in Ukraine, and during the first month of the conflict, there were all these rumors that Russian troops coming there and fighting and helping the rebels, and there were so many rumors besides that. So there was a big fight in Donetsk airport, which after lasted for months and months, but it was the first one in the end of May. And after that, journalists got the news that there will be a truck with the bodies, which will be sent to be repatriated, the bodies to Russia. And it was just a shock for all the journalists. Because this news came from the Donetsk People's Republic authorities, and so they officially accepted that there are Russian citizens coming to Ukraine and fighting for the rebels. And we went to the morgue, where the coffins were stored, and there were so many journalists, Russian official TV, European newspapers, like everybody, photographers, writers. And from some moment, they sent the truck from the morgue full of coffins, and most of the journalists left because they decided the bodies are inside, so the story is done. But for me, it was very important to find out what is it really true that there are Russian citizens there, or like how it can be and how they are going to be repatriated. So me and three of my colleagues, we decided to follow this story from the beginning up to the end. And it became one of the most important news stories published in Russia on that war. We found out that the bodies were stored in the ice cream factory in Donetsk, and we were waiting for hours while the activists were loading the coffins in the truck. And it was all surreal, like we couldn't get if it's really true and the truck will be sent to the border. In the long run, they sent it, and they were begging, literally begging journalists to follow this truck. So somehow maybe the Donetsk People's Republic's authorities, they were afraid that this truck will be attacked by the Ukrainian army, because it was supposed to pass the Ukrainian checkpoints, because the border was under control of the Ukrainian army and Ukrainian authorities. So we took this trip, and the reaction of the Ukrainian soldiers was just, they were shocked. First, they were putting rifles on the truck because they expected some provocation. After, they were putting like weapons at us because they expected us to be, as journalists, I mean, to be part of the provocation. But after they received this paper saying that this is the official paper of the hospital in Donetsk, saying that like the bodies are supposed to be repatriated, one paper at each coffin saying that there is nothing like prohibited inside the body. So they checked all of this and they let it go to the border. And my trip finished on the border because I understood that I could cross to Russia, but I understood that this story is very important, and on the Russian side there will be almost no opportunity to report it up to the end. So I came back to Donetsk, and I wrote this, the first time I wrote the article on this matter, because I considered this to be very important. So this was one of the stories which made the public opinion on this war. And from this story, the activists in Russia and families, and like they got the testimony that this is going on. Russian volunteers are going there. It is the biggest question, who are they officially or unofficially, but that was the first story proving that Russian citizens going to fight in Ukraine. And that was the sign of something new going on in Russia as well, besides the war in Ukraine, and it is still now. So that was the one of the significant stories which went besides this line, which went from the Russian side to the Ukrainian side, and like me, I was able to follow it. And most of the times, it takes more negotiation, it takes more efforts just to find trust in both sides, and pointing that I don't take any part and any side, and I'm here to report on what's going on. In Ukraine, it's very hard to explain to people, to civilians, to the separatists, to the Ukrainian soldiers or battalion, or to the battalion soldiers. The meaning of a journalist in Ukraine is totally modified now, and it went upside down. So, yeah, that's it.
Thank you very much, Maria. Well, I'm sure I certainly have questions, and I know the audience does too, but we want to hear from all of our speakers first. So, Nina, you want to talk about embedding.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. It was a great presentation that Maria made. I want to talk about embedding from the American standpoint. And so thinking about embedding as photographers, it occurred to me that the popular American perception of what war is and what it looks like, its narrative arc, comes mainly from images taken by photographers who were assisted by the military or embedded with military troops. As a result, the images we see are primarily images of troops. And so when we think about ethics and embeds, it's not simply the issue of what a photographer can and can't shoot while in this restricted space, or the potential conflict about what one's role is as a journalist covering people who are also giving you safety, food, and shelter. The broader ethical question, I think, is what are we leaving out when we embed, when photographers, media companies decide to focus our gaze so narrowly on troops as opposed to civilians, women, children, and what we sometimes call collateral damage. Since Alexander Gardner, the famous Civil War photographer, Americans have been taught to equate war with ground troops. Gardner was embedded with the Army of the Potomac. He himself was an honorary captain. His pictures were groundbreaking and influential because they were harrowing and graphic in nature, immediacy, and they lacked sentimentality. They tell us a great deal about the grim nature of battlefield death, but they tell us very little about the impact of the Civil War on civilian populations or on the why, the reasons for war, and the institution of slavery. In World War II, given the tens of millions of people who died, it's kind of incredible to consider that the most widely published picture, at least in the American media landscape, is not an image from concentration camps or the atomic annihilation of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. It's a rather simple photo of 5 US Marines and 1 Navy corpsman raising an American flag on Iwo Jima. This picture was taken by AP photographer Joe Rosenthal in 1945. He arrived on Iwo Jima by Marine transport, and he walked up that hill alongside military staff photographers. The event was kind of a military photo op ordered by a colonel who wanted a second flag raised. This image was then used to sell billions of dollars worth of war bonds. It inspired a Hollywood movie. It has served as a model for a Marine memorial in Washington. It reportedly led the Secretary of the Navy at the time to say that the image would ensure the Marine Corps' existence for the next 100 years. And maybe most importantly, it influenced countless photographers and photo editors about how and what they see when they think of war. After World War II, as American foreign policy ambitions expanded across the globe, the focus of war photography still remained on the troops, which means that America's wars, no matter where they took place, continued to focus on Americans themselves. Life magazine sent Larry Burroughs to embed with the Marines from 1964 on in Vietnam, and he produced a tremendous body of work about U.S. troops. It wasn't all rosy. here you have Marines, not in victory, but in disillusion, despair, blood, very close, very graphic. Military embeds made these images possible. Burroughs' pictures and those of his colleagues served to contradict the Pentagon propaganda at the time that the war was going well and that America was winning. In that way, they served an intent of journalism to speak to truth to power. But few photographers, except for Philip Jones Griffith, maybe, and a few others, attempted pictures that actually brought Vietnamese people into the frame. The most famous image to do that, and perhaps one of the greatest anti-war pictures made, was taken by a young Vietnamese photographer, Nick Út, working for the Associated Press, not in an embed, who said his dream was to make a picture that would stop the war. It's widely accepted that photojournalists helped turn public opinion against the Vietnam War. In future conflict, the American press was reined in, and coverage was limited in the first Gulf War, Grenada, and Panama. Media companies got angry, they protested, and when the Iraq War was poised to begin, the Pentagon offered a controlled embed. Journalists were invited to ride along and live the life with military units. They would get a front seat look at the war as it unfolded. In March 2003, there were more than 700 embedded journalists, and we got a lot of pictures like this. The pictures you see here are taken from a series that the Denver Post ran in the 9th anniversary of the Iraq War. So not only are these pictures published when they're made, but then they're recycled year after year after year, depending upon the propensities of photo editors and their point of view. And so they live on in history as the record of the war. But for some very careful and patient photographers, embeds also provided an excellent window into the style of American occupation that was unfolded in Iraq. You have this picture by a French photographer shot for AFP. And these next two pictures were taken by Chris Hondros, an American photographer who was later killed in Libya. This shows the treatment of Iraqis under who had been interrogated by the U.S. Marines, and then this very famous picture of a five-year-old girl whose parents had just been murdered by American military forces who fired into her parents' vehicle. Once it became clear the war was not going so well for the Americans, the rules of the embeds changed. And I'd like to play you a short YouTube clip made by Mike Camber, who teaches at Columbia, and was also a photographer for the New York Times for several years in Iraq. So let me see if I can pull this up. Okay.
I think that there has to be an accurate visual record of the war, and I think it's going to be a much bloodier, much harder visual record than the one that we've been seeing. My name is Mike Camber, and I'm a contract photographer at the New York Times. I covered the war in Iraq for a number of years. In 2003-2004, we worked quite freely. You know, we would make up a unit and go and do whatever we wanted. We cover firefights, we cover car bombings, we cover whatever was happening. And then slowly, things just became off-limits. At first, the car bombs were off-limits, and then we couldn't photograph hospitals, and then the mortars were off-limits, and then we couldn't photograph prisoners, and then we couldn't photograph wounded soldiers. And at a certain point, they said, you can't photograph the detainees. You can't photograph the captives. And when we said, why? They said, well, we're protecting their rights. The photos served as a type of evidence to show the condition of the detainees when they were arrested, which in fact might even protect their rights. Even if you were told you couldn't do this or that, you tried to take a picture from an angle that didn't show a face, or you know, you tried to shoot from the hip when you could. And some things we took and we knew we couldn't publish it then, but there are things that we'll publish in history books or we'll publish in the future to provide a real record of the war. This was a picture that I took in Latafia in 2007, I think. And basically, I was on patrol with a bunch of guys. We got hit by an IED. One soldier was immediately killed. I ran out and started to photograph, like in this instance, with this soldier pointing his gun. You can still see the smoke in the background. The captain yelled out, he said, no pictures, no pictures, you can't photograph. I went over to him and said, look, I'm going to do my job, and you can take my cameras later. The U.S. military warned us against publishing the photos. They said that we would lose our access, that we'd be kicked out of the MDA. They said, you can't publish a photo that shows an identifiable wounded soldier. And we said, okay, well, we have one where the soldier's face is bandaged, so he's not identifiable. And then they said, well, can you identify any of the faces of the other soldiers in the unit? And then later they said, well, are there military patches visible in the photo? So we went through all the photos, and we found the one photo where there were no patches available, and we used that. Now the Iraqis have taken over security in Baghdad. And, the Iraqis have been very clear that you cannot photograph car bomb scenes, you cannot photograph casualties. For them, you're doing propaganda for the insurgents. You're showing the effects of these attacks. In this instance, these soldiers were extremely emotional. That's a female soldier who's lying on the hood of a Humvee, and she lost her arm. She was a well-known female basketball player. The soldiers were furious, and, they pointed their guns at me, and this guy screaming, if he takes another photo, shoot him. And I don't know that they would have shot me, but, that's the type of thing that happens in these situations. They don't want a bunch of photographers around snapping photos, and it just, to them, it feels disrespectful. And, that's understandable, but, we're trying to balance that with doing our jobs as journalists.
And so, not only were you restricted at some point in Iraq, but in Afghanistan, I would say that the focus on the troops was even more intense. You had a very strange series of pictures that unfolded in 2008, 2007, taken by some of the most famous, prominent photojournalists in the world working for the biggest publications. It seemed like everybody needed to go to this one outpost in the Karangal Valley in Afghanistan and photograph really not much. And so this is John Moore, Getty Images, Lindsay Addario, New York Times Magazine, David Guttenfelder, the AP, and Tim Hetherington, a much loved, celebrated photographer who was also killed in Libya. It's not that these aren't amazing pictures, but I really have to question, why do media companies invest so much energy, put their journalists at so much risk for such a narrow view? With Tim Hetherington, it became even more narrow. So that by the end of his time in the Karangal Valley, he was photographing sleeping soldiers and said publicly he wasn't even interested in the combat anymore. He was interested in the relationships between the soldiers. And that's fine. You can have your own point of view and your intention for being in a place. But when you are in some ways an occupying power, and when you are existing in someone else's country, don't you think that there's an ethical obligation to photograph as well? What are on the other side of those weapons? And to make it even more complicated, these pictures are now art pieces. They're art objects, and you can go to photography shows, and you can pay many thousands of dollars to get a limited edition print of a sleeping soldier. So, thank you for listening.
Thank you, Nina. I think you've made a powerful case that we need to look well beyond the soldiers. And Judith, I know you want to talk about civilians and some of the issues raised.
Yeah, I think the picture you're getting is it's really, really difficult to cover conflicts and to do it properly with balance. I teach a course on covering conflict, and I usually start it by saying when you cover these type of stories where access is so limited and life can be at stake, yours and the subjects that you're shooting meaning taking pictures of or covering, there's sort of one word when it comes to ethics, which is it depends. So a lot of what we take as normal ethical behavior in journalism, for instance, you don't pay bribes. You pay bribes when you cover a conflict. You have to cross that checkpoint. There's a 14-year-old guy who's high on amphetamines and he's pointing a Kalashnikov at you and he says, give me money for a soft drink, which is a euphemism for drive. You give the guy $20. Otherwise, you can't do it. You want to get access. When I worked in Chechnya, I needed to get access at one point to one particularly fraught area. So I brought a bottle of brandy to the commander, the Russian commander. Another time in Angola, I needed to get on a helicopter, which was the only way to get around, military helicopter. I brought a live chicken to the general. I mean, you can't do this on Wall Street. You can't, maybe you buy somebody lunch, but you can't bring a bottle of brandy to an interview and have it be understood that this is acceptable behavior. But in these kind of situations, you have to resort to what in other circumstances would be considered unacceptable. The other thing is, you know, as journalists, you're supposed to be objective. We all aim towards that. You're not supposed to get involved with your subjects. But if you have knowledge of medical aid and there's a child in front of you whose arm has just been blown off and you know how to apply a tourniquet and save that person's life, it depends. Some journalists will intervene at that point, put their pencils and their pens and their cameras down and try to save a life. Others won't. And I think it really depends on your conscience, what you can live with at the end of the day. And I think both of them are acceptable. But in other circumstances, this doesn't come up, these kind of moral questions of do you suddenly stop being a journalist and get involved? Does it, you know, is it a matter? And there are quite a few journalists, well, not quite a few, there's a handful of journalists who are trained physicians. And they have, you know, in places like Haiti or Katrina or elsewhere, they have actually stopped being journalists for an hour or two or even longer and have performed operations or life-saving actions. And I think, you know, it's something that I think one has to think about before one goes out into the arena of what are my limits and what am I going to do? Because when you're suddenly faced with it, it's a sudden decision. I'll give you an example of one. I was, again, in Angola where I spent a lot of time. And what happened is these rebels that were armed by our government were besieging cities. It was a Maoist attack, the UNITA rebels. And they were starving these cities. This was in the 90s. And the only way to get in was to embed, but with the United Nations. So you would go on a United Nations aid flight. They would basically drop food to these starving, hungry people and then fly out. So I went on one to a city called Luena, and as we were flying this big Antonov cargo plane, suddenly it started doing corkscrews, which the Ukrainian pilots informed me meant that we were being shelled. So we landed, and on the tarmac, which was really just you know, a little more than a field, there's about 50 bloodied people, you know, moaning, who had been hit by the shells and whatnot. And so the UN people started, you know, they just turned to me and they said, help us get the food off of the plane and help us load the bodies on. Now, what are you going to do? You're going to say, no, I'm a journalist. I'm not going to help you. You know, it's that was my decision. But these are the kind of things we face in the field. And it's, you know, it depends. The other thing, you know, which I think aside from depends, is you have to think do no harm. You know, go to the limits that you feel are comfortable with your own personal moral barometer, but just make sure you're not doing any harm. And to that effect, you know, you cannot carry a gun. It's just unacceptable. You cannot carry a weapon. It's against the Geneva Convention, and it also makes you a participant. So while it's okay to aid people who are harmed and hurt and give medical aid, it is thoroughly not acceptable to carry a gun. And usually the way journalists get around is they hire other people who carry guns to protect them. And it was, when it came to accounting purposes, in Somalia in the 90s, there actually was a word for it, technikos, technicians. And oh, and that's the other thing. With bribes, we call them gratuities. So you have these euphemisms to get past the accountants when you want to claim your expenses. But, you know, again, just to give you another example of how you have to make these rapid decisions, I was one time in what's now Democratic Republic of Congo, and now, well, but it was called Zaire then, got on a plane, landed in the city, Kisangani, and immediately these barefoot men in underwear with giant guns stormed onto the plane. They were soldiers who'd been rioting, and they commandeered the plane. They flew off. And I'm there with two other correspondents. We're like stuck in Kisangani with a bunch of rioting soldiers, which was not a very comfortable place to be. And so a businessman who was on our plane said, look, you know, I have a lot of money, and I'm getting to where you want to go, which is the one hotel. So why don't we just put our money together and hire some security, and they'll get us to the hotel. And then we got to the hotel, and we hired machine gunners to defend us. Now, is this ethical? You know, what was I going to do? I was going to, like, sit in the middle of the street in Kisangani and be killed. You know, it depends. It's just really, really murky when you get out there. But again, it's really, really important to know how you're going to behave and what lengths you're going to go to before you go there. There's another thing, and again, this is more on the coverage side rather than civilian. I do a lot of safety work in Mexico. As a matter of fact, I'm heading back there next week. And we're supposed to tell the full story of everything we see. We're supposed to give the full story. But in Mexico, journalists can't do that. I mean, there have been dozens and dozens of journalists killed, and they can't publish openly anymore. Now, technically, you could say that's unethical, that they're abnegating their jobs as journalists. But on the other hand, they're going to be slaughtered. They have to have self-censorship. What are they going to do? So, you know, the ethics become so blurry in these situations. You know, you can't possibly fault a colleague for not publishing something that would get them killed. Then what's the point? You know, all you can do is hope that they can leak the information to other people, or that one day a better day will come and that they can cover the stories the way they want to and the way the profession would hopefully demand. Just one last thing, and I think this is something that our photographers can address far better than myself. I'm a print person, whereas they're visual, which is, I know one thing that quite a few visual colleagues struggle with is the balance between giving dignity to the subjects and at the same time depicting the depravity and the horror. And, you know, I don't know if this has come up in your class at all, but, you know, the picture of the young girls naked there in My Lai running, it turned out she was fine with that photograph later in life. But on the one hand, you could say that it did rob her of some dignity. At least she was prepubescent. I mean, if she hadn't been, it would have raised some very, very big issues. Ebola, which isn't a war classically, but is definitely a natural war, there was a lot of debate about, do you show the absolute horror of these people who are no longer wearing their trousers because they've soiled them? There were quite a few pictures of people without their trousers on. There were quite a few pictures and video, particularly in the New York Times, of people waiting outside clinics that couldn't accept them, smeared with their own feces and vomit. Now, that definitely shows the horror of Ebola, but does it rob these people of dignity? And it's, you know, you can address this better than myself, but it's a really, really tricky balance of, you know, let's say you're dealing with mass rape victims. Okay, you shouldn't give their names, you shouldn't show their faces, but at the same time, you know, to describe what's been done to them is important, but it has to be in a way that doesn't rob them of their humanity. So, you know, these are some of the ethical issues that we're struggling with, and I don't think there's an easy answer for those. Just like, well, it's just really, it's a difficult thing to navigate, and I think it's going to be endlessly debated as to what the proper road is to take on some of these issues. So.
Great, thank you, all three of you. We have until about 1:30, and I'm sure that people in the audience have questions, so I just want to throw out one thing and then turn it over to you for your questions. Maria, I want to go back to, you said something like, War was made first of all in Ukraine by media, and we have heard so much about the information war around this conflict, and you know, Russia speaks about information war with the United States. There's, you know, there are all of these words that are used. When you showed your accreditation from the Defense Ministry, I don't know if anybody noticed, but it says ATO press card. And when I asked Maria the other day, what's that stand for? It's anti-terrorism operation. So that's how the Ukrainian government is characterizing what they are doing in eastern Ukraine, whereas, you know, the other side fighting in eastern Ukraine says we are fighting against fascism, Nazis. You know, the rhetoric is pretty horrible and pretty heated. And so I'd love to hear more from you about that. And I also would love to hear from both Nina and Judith about, is that really very different from other conflicts? It kind of feels like it, but I don't know whether that's because in this moment when we're reading, you know, daily about this conflict, it just is kind of horrifying to see how deeply politicized it is.
Yeah, like if we speak on like the Ukrainian war from the very beginning, like it was a year ago when it all started, and actually tomorrow will be the anniversary when the entire terrorist operation was announced by the Ukrainian government. And from the very beginning, this was total separation on two worlds. In on one side, they called those who just went to fight in Donbass separatists or terrorists. On another side, they're rebels and they're protectors of their own land. On one side, it is called in Russia, in Russian news, it's called punitive operation. In the Ukrainian news, it is called anti-entire terrorist operation. So, liberated territory, occupied territory, and everything which is happening and doesn't go along with this or that political line, it's called a provocation. This, when I said that this war was made by media, I meant that in the very beginning, the contradictions between people were not so big. When I traveled to the East Ukraine in the beginning of April, people were saying like, yeah, we don't understand this new government, but you know, we're one country, so maybe they will come and like talk to us, so maybe we will understand them better. And in a month, they were already like asking us journalists, did you see these tanks with swastika? You know, this Pravi Sektor, which is the radical like organization and the biggest fear for people in Donbass. Do you know that this Pravi Sektor is all around the forest? They are like coming to kill us, because this is what was said in the Russian news. And moreover, people began to live in this reality. I mean, both sides. In Kyiv, it was impossible to talk to the like Ukrainian journalists about and telling them that, yeah, there are some people who are against the new government and they really participate in the separatist movement. It was just impossible. They were saying no, like the journalists, they were saying no, it's not true, it's like there are only Russian troops there, so on, and it's still now like this. So the total dehumanizing and total refuse to accept that there are people who are against this or that, or there are people who fight or who stand up for like new life in Kyiv, or those who stand up against this and like became, it was just the simple matter of fear. Just people were scared. And media made this work. They burned the fear, the anger, they rose it to the highest level, and that's what we have now, the war.
Any thoughts?
You know, the problem with polarized narrative is it's really common. I mean, think about I was in Israel and the West, or Palestine, as Palestinians will call it, in January, and I met with journalists from both sides, and I felt like I was in two separate places. The interpretation of events, who was seen, who saw themselves as victims and whatnot, and who assigned blame. And, you know, it really struck me, it would be a most complicated place to work, particularly as a foreign correspondent, coming in and hearing both narratives. You know, how do you decide which one is the correct one? And I, it's not easy. It's not easy. And you look at Thailand, where the narrative, where both sides are so polarized that there's really no neutral line coming through. And, I think that on top of the ethics makes it really complicated. But I have a question for Maria, which is, you're a Russian citizen, right? Yeah. Did the Russian authorities weigh on you at any point?
No.
No, not even when you did the story about the coffins and whatnot?
No. Actually, for me, it was somehow easier because I'm a freelancer. I don't work for any Russian newspaper or foreign newspaper as officially. Those journalists who work on Novaya Gazeta, for example, it's more or less like objective newspaper reporting a lot on what is going on now in Ukraine. They face this kind of pressure, and me not, because I'm totally like out of everything. I just like. I'm independent, and I report that what I just want to report.
And do you think that, sorry, I'm asking a question here, but do you think the fact that a lot of your work is published abroad gives you a guard almost, a security that wouldn't otherwise? Like if you were freelancer for local media?
You know, the only one thing which is can give some secure is that Russian people will not see it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, as far as my work doesn't appear in the TV, it causes me no threat.
Right.
Like, even if the Russian authorities, they like see my work or they, the story on the Russian citizens being killed and repatriated, it was published in Russia in the internet, and after it appeared in the paper. But still, it's not the overall audience, so it's kind of limited audience, which okay, they get the news, and actually it started a lot of work of the activists and like yeah, but still it's not the all Russia, and still it's kind of isolated.
I wanted to ask, in the Cargo 200 story, so you're saying, you know, these were Russian citizens, they were being repatriated. Were they actively still part of the Russian military? Or how did you describe them?
You know, we tried to, me and my colleagues, afterwards, after all the story happened, we tried to find out more about these people. First of all, we couldn't manage to get the list of the names. So what we saw, the names, we saw only like from the shoulder of the Ukrainian soldier who was checking that, and I took some pictures, and afterwards, I was checking the internet, like we're discussing this with the colleagues, and we found out that we found four last names, like four names. One guy was the former kind of special security guy with the military experience, but he was about 60, so he was kind of out of service for sure. So from that repatriation company, we didn't find much about who these people are. But there was one person, and I followed that. The relatives of him contacted me. They read this piece, and they said, you know, our relative, he went to fight in Ukraine. We keep quiet about that, but we got this news about airport, and we saw your article, so maybe he's there. Mm-hmm. Can you help us to, like... And I was asking, who was he? And they said he was in the army, just like as a normal 2 years service. And that's it. He was a businessman. He was doing his job. And after, he decided to go. What happened in Odessa on the 2nd of May, when there were clashes and there were, like... people were burned in the after the clashes, it turned a lot of Russian citizens to go and to kind of protect these people in Ukraine. But this is what is going on, but it's not what is really discussed. So from that guy, we understood that, yes, there is this, it is going on when the Russian people from different cities, it doesn't matter how much they earn, it doesn't matter what is the education or military experience, they do go to fight to Donbass. And the relatives, they couldn't find the body. They were searching for about a week. They were begging different official authorities to tell them if, like, they can, where they can just see the bodies and identify their relative. Maybe he's there, maybe he is not. They didn't have any news from him, and they knew for sure that he was fighting in Donbass. So only because I followed this story and I just pressed somehow the driver, like, asking him a lot of questions, he told me the place where he unloaded this, and only because of this we found out the place where they were unloaded in Russia, and we put the pressure on the authorities, so they contacted their relatives, but again, mm-hmm. secretively. Mm-hmm. It was not in the news, it was never discussed.
Okay, thank you. So there is a microphone here if you have a question. Yeah, and this is being recorded. So please, if you have a question, go to the microphone, and it would be great if you could identify yourself. Yeah.
My name is Chandrakant Pancholi from Overseas India Weekly, and I would like to know how you care for your safety. Right, particularly being woman, you have a double jeopardy, and how do you manage to do that? And now, second question is about embedding with United States troops. So do you think that it will be almost useless now because the military is placing so many restrictions? Thank you.
The first question is for me.
The first question is about safety. Did you live together, all journalists, in a war zone? And whether, how did you travel? And whether your life was in almost risk and you faced death sometime?
Do you
want to
start about what, or maybe you start?
Okay. Well, we're having a 4-day workshop on this starting Thursday if you want to take part. This is another one where it depends, because what the safety measures you would take, let's say, in a place like Zaire would be different from what you would do in Ukraine. So before you even set out on a trip, you'd do a risk assessment. You'd figure out what would be the dangers. Would they be rape? Would they be abduction? Would they be crossfire? Whatever. And then from there, you try to work back and come up with a plan. A plan of contingency, and also something to mitigate the risks themselves. So whether you move in a big group alone, which I wouldn't recommend anywhere, or with just one or two other people, really depends on the actual situation. Let's say if you're covering civil disorder and demonstrations and riots, you don't want to move in a big group. You want to move ideally with three people. So it really, I mean, I could go on about this for days, but it really... each particular situation has its own nuances, and the best thing to do is do as much research as possible, talk to human rights groups, journalist advocacy groups, talk to other colleagues, both international colleagues and local colleagues. For instance, the risks facing a Russian journalist might be very different from a French journalist, so you have to be aware of what your nationality awards you in terms of protection or assigns you in terms of greater risks. And that's it. And, you know, the one thing that I am heartened by is that I think there's greater awareness of safety measures and protocols. When I started out doing this kind of stuff in the late 80s, early 90s, we didn't carry flak jackets. I remember walking on a mine dump that had been blown up. Like, nobody told me you shouldn't walk on an ammunition dump after being blown up. I mean, I think now pretty much people know about that kind of thing. The questions you asked in terms of being a woman, it depends on the particular culture. A friend of mine was kidnapped in Somalia at a particular time, and she was left alone. 20, 30 years later, another woman was kidnapped in Somalia, was gang raped. And so I think you have to be aware of the particular dangers. Obviously, you don't want to go to Tahrir Square as a woman alone in Egypt. That's a place where a lot of women have been assaulted. But then there are other places where women can walk around and be unmolested. So again, it's, you know, it's very site-specific. I mean, there are plenty of precautions that women can take in terms of walking, you know, being accompanied, maybe having armed guards with them. I think the best thing to do is get a rape, a door alarm. It costs $8. You order it on Amazon, and you put it on your hotel door. And if anybody tries to open it, it gives off the most god-awful screech you can imagine. I mean, that's probably the best thing to keep you safe in any hotel room. Nobody can stand the noise, including yourself. So, you know, again, there's like a whole list of measures, and there's safety guides out there. The organization that Anne used to head, the Committee to Protect Journalists, has a 65-page guide on every possible circumstance you can think about. But there is one new changing arena, which is digital safety. And, you know, I mean, I was detained in a really uncomfortable, horrible situation in Dagestan. And the way the anti-terrorism forces got to me was by monitoring my digital communications. So that's a whole new area of risk that we're still plotting out. So anyway, but I want to hear what Maria does to protect herself, because I'm getting worried about you.
If we speak about Ukraine, the biggest issue for the journalist is not whether you are a man or a woman, like for when you go in the dangerous areas, it's whether you're Russian or you're European, the media you work for. In general, in Ukraine, we figured out this scheme of traveling in a car. The better combination will be one lady and two men, or one Russian citizen, and two European or American, because for Americans it's more like it's not really comfortable for the American journalists to work there, so they prefer to have somebody from Russia in their car. It can be a driver. Some of those who live in Donbas, they have Russian citizenship as well. So what about the safety in the matter of crossfire? That's the best source for us were the drivers, because they woke up early in the morning, they knew each other, they called, they all had their relative or somebody on the checkpoint. So the drivers were the source of the safety information to build up your day and to understand where is risky to go or what you should avoid. And actually, the digital safety, for me it became very important, because I crossed the lines. So sometimes there will be one village or one town. On one side there will be the Ukrainian checkpoint, on another side there will be a separatist checkpoint. And for me, going from this small distance, of course they realized that I just came there from another side. And for me, the biggest issue was not to show any one picture of what I got on that side. With the pro-Russian gunman, it was more or less like a chat, and it was like, I never paid bribes, nothing, like, luckily. But it was more like a chat, like trying to bring them away from the point of the discussion. On the Ukrainian checkpoint, I was once in very, very, very unpleasant situation when they were kind of pushing me to show what I got. And I told them, like, look, I'm here now showing you what I get on that side, and the next time I go, I will have to show like what I get from your side. So it's kind of stopped them, and they didn't push more. And I mean, in general, most of the time you can negotiate, and that's okay. But there are different situations, and in the beginning it was more when journalists were put in the basement, like Simon Ostrovsky from Vice. He was there for 3 days because he was reporting on the American media. Simon Schuster from Time, he was banned on the... But again, he's American citizen, so they really... They don't like American journalists there. Now it's better. Now it's more or less safe to travel, and they got some system of controlling their gunmen, and you can always find the commander and just complain.
I like that. Find a commander and complain.
Yeah, one more question.
Hi, I'm Max Tejada. I'm a graduate student at the Harriman Institute. Thank you all for this fascinating presentation, and Maria, your wonderful photos. I was wondering, you spoke about there being propaganda on both sides, and we've heard a lot here about sort of Russian propaganda about the war. I was wondering if you could talk a bit about the reporting in the Western media and how that matched up to what you saw there. Mm-hmm. Thanks very much.
Yeah, actually, it's another issue in the covering of the war in Ukraine. Before, in the beginning, the Western media, they mostly followed the like Ukrainian line, and I remember this ridiculous publication in New York Times when they tried to find the some signs to prove that Russian like special forces or Russian troops are like. Involved in the armed unrest in the East Ukraine, and they found this guy. I have his. I showed him in the slideshow. The pro-Russian gunman called Babai with a big beard. So he caught a lot of attention of the journalists because he was not covering, he was showing up, he liked to like to talk. And New York Times, they made the publication finding some guy who looked pretty much as that Babai from East Ukraine, but not really, like, you could see the difference. And they were saying that this guy was the same guy from the Georgian war, and it's like, and we all looked at this publication with the eyes like this. So sometimes Western medias, they were pushing for an idea, and it was really unpleasant because it affected pretty much those who worked at the place. So next time you go to separatists, they will say, "Aha, you're saying this, so we like get out of here. We hate French news, or we hate American journalists." I faced the same actually in Kiev. It was right after, before the elections, when I made another project, making like it's what's called My Country in 5 years. When I went all around Kiev asking, "What do you think? What will be with Ukraine in 5 years? Will you be in European Union? Will you be in, like, where will you be?" And I stopped by a Pravi Sektor activist. He was really a Pravi Sektor activist, all dressed with the Ukrainian national costume, something like this, in Maidan. And she told me, "French news?" I was making this for Le Monde again. And she said, "Ah, you're a French journalist? Step out of me, otherwise I will beat you." And I was like, "Okay, like, why? What's going on?" She said, "Yeah, these French journalists, they made something about like me, and I don't like it." And I told her, like, "You cannot blame all French journalists on that." And yeah, "Okay, where are you from?" "I'm from Moscow." "Okay, you're from Moscow." And she was like, "You know, I could bury you in my like yard," something like this, she said. But yeah, I talked to her for a couple of minutes, and she gave me interview and allowed to take picture. But it's like, what is going on in both sides of the conflict? They follow the news, and they and the Western media, they push a lot. They push for the coverage, so it makes people upset.
Okay, not sure we've solved anything here today, but I think you all got the point that this is a very complex area of reporting for journalists, regardless of where they're doing it and where they're from, even. So, Maria, Nina, Judith, thank you very, very much. Thank you.